Hi guys, Amores here. Today we are checking out this huge 3D graphics accelerator from Intergraph, a company founded in 1969 and involved in projects with NASA and US Army, a big player in the computer-aided design industry, but also in the workstation industry. In the summer of 2000, Intergraph sold its graphics accelerator division to 3D Labs and its workstation and server division to Silicon Graphics. But they are still alive as a part of Hexagon, a big Swedish software company. And speaking of staying alive, surprisingly, on the intergraph.com, we still can find the user manual for our workstation video card. More exactly, this is a RealiZm II ZX25/T card manufactured in March 1998. T means that this card has texture processing capabilities. As you can see in the manual, it was possible to use multiple cards at once. Well, I guess this won't happen anytime soon since these cards are pretty rare, mostly because they were not cheap at all, and they came as a part of a workstation, which was even more expensive. Now, let's go back to our big card. Today, it's more about compatibility with modern and faster hardware, so it's not gonna be some in-depth performance review. First of all, let's check if this card works on a modern system. So let's make this card even bigger by adding two PCI Express to PCI adapters and plug this card on an Intel 13th gen configuration. I guess no one tried to use two PCI Express adapters on an older 3D graphics accelerator, so anything could happen. But don't worry, 007 is here to help. Just kidding, our Intergraph card booted just fine on this Asus H110 business motherboard with an Intel Core i3 13th gen CPU with 16 gigabytes of RAM. Usually we are seeing this info on the post screen, but with this card the Windows NT bootloader is taking over straight away. So far, the 2D daughter board with a very common Cirrus Logic CL5440 2D chip is used. But since we are in Windows NT4, the 3D part should be available as well. At least the driver is working. Intergraph also sold 3D accelerators under Intense 3D brand. And while there is no Intense 3D mentioned in the manual, later drivers will use Intense 3D branding.
We could use our technology to help feed the world. But then we thought, hey, we could use it for games.
This was a cut from an older 3DFX commercial, but I guess it's mandatory to see how Intense can an expensive business 3D accelerator run games like Quake 2, for example. So far, so good. The 3D part is initialized successfully. The GL vendor is Intergraph Corporation, and we are using 32-bit depth. Pretty fancy for a 1997 design. Some blue stuff is going on the screen. Otherwise, everything looks pretty good. But this is how far our benchmark goes. Might be the driver, the PCI Express adapters, or the whole this very unsupported configuration. Or might be the card as well. So let's double check it on a more PCI-friendly motherboard like this Asus P4S800 from 2004 with a SIS 648 chipset, which is supposed to be very friendly with PCI video cards. From what I read on Vogons, these Pentium 4 motherboards might be the only ones where a Voodoo 1 card can operate with very fast CPUs. I was about to check this theory with the custom Voodoo 1 cards received from SDZMouse.com, but I had to return them. No problem, they will be back for a future video. On a motherboard with plenty of PCI slots, our double slot card will just fit for me in place. Too bad that some huge nowadays RTX cards are not using a second dummy PCI Express connector for stability, just for that. We are using the same Windows NT installation. I didn't have to reinstall anything. The CPU, it's a Northwood Pentium 4 running at 2.4 gigahertz. I guess we don't have any bottleneck when it comes to Quake 2 or Quake 1. And now the 3D accelerator simply works. We get about 60 frames at 320 by 240 in Quake 2. Some 3D accelerators won't do this resolution. At 640 by 480, we get 26.6 frames, which is not that bad considering that the game is running in 32-bit depth. In GLQuake, we get about 30 frames at 640 by 480. Again, the game is running in 32-bit color depth. The intense 3D driver won't let us set any desktop resolution other than 32-bit true color. So I guess I had to start both Quake games with a custom line command to use a 16-bit color depth. I will do this in a future video. Another id Software title that works well, although it was released in late 2001, is Return to Castle Wolfenstein. This game specifically requires a minimum 16 megabytes OpenGL compatible card. No problem, we have plenty of video memory. There are some texture artifacts here and there, but if you ask me, the game is totally playable. This card is supposed to work in Windows 2000 as well. This can be very interesting because we can test way more OpenGL games in Windows 2K. And indeed, there are official Windows 2000 drivers. I tried a few, but I didn't have any luck. I'm sure I can do it in a future video. That's it for today. Thanks for watching and subscribing. Did you subscribe? Did you? Okay, thanks.